Good evening. I'm Bobby Scafish of WLUP Chicago, and I'd like to welcome you to a unique radio event. Robert Plant is here with us in the studio, and for the next hour, he'll be talking with you both over the air and on the phone at 1-900-210-7625. Promises to be a special evening, so please stay with us. We just heard is Other Arms, one of the songs from the second Robert Plant solo album, The Principle of Moments. Now, Monday night of this week, Robert Plant kicked off his first solo tour here in Chicago to glowing reviews across the board. I'm Bobby Scafish of WLUP here in Chicago, and tonight we'll be finding out a whole lot more about the tour, the solo recording career, and Robert Plant's plans for the future. Joining me here in the studio, we have Lee Arnold of 93 QFM in Milwaukee, and Jack Silver from Casey in St. Louis, two of the cities that Robert just played this week, so I imagine we'll be hearing a whole lot more about how the shows went. And, of course, we welcome your participation via our direct phone line at 1-900-210-7625, or, if you prefer, 1-900-210-ROCK. Use this number to pose your question to Robert Plant. Robert, welcome to the Loop Studios.
Thank you. Seems very tiny, very neat. Smell of pipe smoke in the air. Very nice.
You know, I read recently, in NME, New Musical Express, a music paper out of Britain, that along with compromises, lightweights, and overzealous acquaintances, something that you hate is reflected glory. Can you expand on this?
Well, I suppose along the way, there are people who've I've had dealings with who've probably taken the whole rock and roll syndrome far more to their head than the people who are actually responsible for creating it. So you do get the odd, what we in England call wallies. Mm-hmm. You know, just people who are just, they're always around and they're always absorbing all the glory. And most people who are in the middle of working don't really take much notice of, it's only there if you want to see it anyway. Mm-hmm. It's usually the insignificant folk who kind of pick up on all that. And then they become a bit of a thorn in the side. But there's not too many now.
Okay. We have plenty of questions to be asked and answered. Right now, Jack Silver of Casey in St. Louis. Jack?
And it's my pleasure to talk to you tonight, Robert, and all of America. I think I'd like to talk about the production credits on your records. Benji LaFleur.
Lefebvre.
I'm sorry. Could you fill us in on Benji's role?
Yeah, Benji started working for Led Zeppelin in about 1974 as a sound engineer, or an assistant sound engineer, and has continued to hold that position ever since. With the demise of Zeppelin, he stayed with me because he was really responsible for just adding those little bits of echo here and there that you might hear, all those spiraling sounds and stuff like that. So he's always been around me, lives by me, and he's one of my best friends.
I see. And how much production responsibilities would you handle on the given projects?
Well, it depends on the song, and it depends on my patience, really. I mean, I'm kind of, as much as I enjoy the conception of the song, and I really get into writing it and arranging it, once we get into the studio, unfortunately, I have the tendency to go, oh, yeah, well, that'll do. And maybe it's not quite good enough. And Benji has got a lot more patience than me. And every time I'm ready to say, that's good enough, he'll go, no, you must do it again. Or do one more. Or why don't you do that? He's like a kind of the failsafe, the production control wizard who's got more patience than anybody else.
All right.
Also with us here is Lee Arnold of WQFM in Milwaukee. And what was the question, please, to Robert?
Yeah, once again, it's great to be with you here tonight, Robert. It's a pleasure. What made you decide to be so accessible in the last number of months? I mean, there's this press conference. There's other things that you've done on national radio. There's a number of meetings with the press. It's nice to have it, but how come?
Well, when I'm working, especially now with this new platform, there are lots of people who would like or prefer to refer to the past. My whole impetus, my whole work, perhaps hunger for work over the last 2 years has been sheerly because I want to put this thing in perspective rather than everybody leaning on the past and everything that came before. I mean, what I'm doing right now is really good and really important, and I'm with some pretty energetic and artistic people. And if I'd have just done the things and sat at home and reflected on it and been proud of it but still sat at home, then I don't think I could have put across so forcibly the fact that this is my intention and this is what counts. So, hence the fact that we're all sitting here in this wonderful surrounding here. Mm.
It's good to have you back.
Thanks. It's nice to be back. I'm stopped smiling, actually.
Now, Lee just spoke of an accessibility. I'd like to introduce the other side of the coin, and that is your LP, The Principle of Moments, seems to not pander to another kind of accessibility. Rather, it seems to throw a bit of a challenge into the listener. There's no song that screams at you hit single from the first listen. I think it's an LP that you can enjoy more with repetitive listenings rather than just the first time through. My question would be, is that intentional to make an LP where it wears well?
Absolutely. Yeah, well, I mean, on my my very occasional trips to the United States, I have listened to the radio, and I've found that the majority of musicians who have been around for a while, or there is, better still, put it better, you can turn on the radio and you can hear so much music where if you're not particularly a fan or a follower of this band, you wouldn't know this band from the next band, from the next band, from the next band. Everybody's got an ambient drum sound, a really big drum sound, and everybody's got a sort of voice things, and the Gibson Les Paul is being played, and the guy's leaning back, and his hair's touching the floor, and he's doing his solos, you know. I mean, the whole radio reeks of it, and I really don't think that I need to compete with all that. Because as far as I'm concerned, and our listeners can tell me that I'm wrong, but I think that we, in the past, I was part of a band that really summed all that up and also had the subtlety and the kind of finesse to amplify that theme and at the same time say that there's a lot more to music than just that. So if the radio waves are going to get clogged up with that kind of mediocre hard rock thing, then I don't wish to be counted amongst it, and I'm not. And I never was.
All right. We're about to go to the phones. We have listeners from all over the country.
This is going to be good.
Yes. Oh, yeah. First, let's, what do you say we run down the tour schedule? Robert Plant doing his premier solo tour of North America. And we'll run down the dates, and then we'll get to the listeners. The Rosemont Horizon, the Arena in Milwaukee, and the Joe Louis Arena in Detroit. The Joe Louis Arena in Detroit is September 3rd. The 4th of September, it's the Richfield Coliseum in Cleveland, Ohio. September 6th, it's the Centrum in Worcester, Massachusetts.
Worcester.
Thank you. The 8th of September, the Forum in Montreal. The 10th of September, Maple Leaf Gardens in Ontario, Canada. The 12th, Madison Square Garden in New York City. The 13th of September, the Civic Center in Hartford, Connecticut. The 14th is the Spectrum in Philadelphia. The 20th of September is the Summit in Houston, Texas. 22nd is the Reunion Arena in Dallas, Texas. 27th is the Forum in Los Angeles, California. And then September 28th, the Coliseum, Oakland, California. And it says here, more to be announced. Let's go to the phones right now.
I can announce another one.
Please do.
Can I announce another one? I don't know what date it is, though.
Well, this is the 1st of September.
Oh, I dare say today's the 1st. I'll accept that. I know we're playing in Memphis. In fact, I think tickets went on sale yesterday. Great town for music. I mean, when somebody said to me, where you want to go? I said, I'll go to Bangkok, Hong Kong. And then they said, well, where'd you like to play? And I just picked out all the towns that I've had a good time in, and I forgot about Memphis.
Elvis country.
Well, Sun country. Sam Phillips country.
There you go. Oh, yeah. Okay, we have Tammy from Cleveland, who is listening tonight on WMMS. Tammy, what's your question for Robert Plant?
Hi, Robert.
Hi, Tammy.
I'd like to know, how your musical approach has changed from what Zeppelin was like and what it's like now.
Well, I don't really... I don't think it's changed really very much at all. I've just continued, like I just said, to try and persevere, to try and take the musical extremes further and further apart. It's been a little more interesting because I'm working with people who never were in musical environments, I don't think, where that was the order of the day, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I think really the purpose is still the same, or even remains the same, but it's just with different players. I just like to try and take the musical side of it one way and try and take the vocal, the kind of melodic side of it. Maybe that's changed, actually. Maybe I'm trying to sing songs now rather than, be a background for the Cadets' version of Meanwhile Back in the Jungle or something like that. What do you think?
Well, you know, I think that so much of the Zeppelin stuff is so great, and now a lot of it from Principal's Moments is very different. How you described it once, some of it was sort of freakier. You know, it's all different and it sounds really good.
I think really with writing and trying to get the Principal of Moments that different from Pictures at 11, I was purposely knowing that if I were ever to actually go on the road again, and I didn't have 10 albums to lean back on, I was only going to have Pictures at 11 and Principal of Moments. I've got to make it as diverse as possible so as I could enjoy playing it, because if I was Asia or something like that, I mean, I might as well just start the show and finish it with one number. So it would be more fun and more creative. And what's happened on stage now is that taking that moral at the beginning of the project on stage, the thing's opening up beyond all belief, so that we're doing things like Messing with the Me, kind of stretching out, Stranger Here Than Over There, stretching out, and the musicians have got the hang of this kind of dynamic, the dynamics of the music and the constant change thing, and I hope it continues. I mean, we've only done 5 gigs, but it's It's really great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to ask you one more thing. Like, do you feel like you're starting over again and you'll continue a career like you were starting over, like, when Zeppelin was in the beginning?
Yeah, most definitely. I mean, there's an air of enthusiasm and a modus operandi, a sort of method of, in amongst the madness. In fact, there is no madness, number one. And I'm very enthusiastic. I didn't think I was ever actually going to get as far as touring because I'd worked so hard doing the one LP, finishing and carrying immediately on with the next one. I thought that my strength and my potence might be knocked a little bit. But it's surprising what you can do when you really want to do it.
That's it. Tammy, thank you for your calls. Let's move on now.
Thank you, Tammy. They should write a song about you, you know.
Tammy. right?
Yeah.
On line number two, we have Lori calling from Lansing, Michigan, and she's listening tonight on station WILS. Lori, what's your question for Robert Plant?
Well, I'm going to be going to the Detroit concert at Joe Louis on the 3rd.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, I was wondering, who is your opening act going to be, and how do you feel about playing Detroit again?
Well, I'll start with the second question first. I'm delighted to play in Detroit again. I knew a lot of people in Detroit, actually. But, so, it's one of my favorite towns. I think last time I went there, we played at that really silly place. What was it called? Can you remember, Laurie?
Don't ask me. I was in Alaska the last time.
Oh, were you? Maybe it was there then. I don't know, but it was just outside Detroit. A big stadium where you could inflate the ceiling. Does that ring any bells? Anyway,
the only places I know of in Detroit are Joe Louis and Cobo and...
Anyway,
then there's the Pontiac Silverdome.
That's the one.
Okay.
Well, this is going to be a little more contained, I think. So I'm really looking forward to playing there again. Some towns get to be like kind of second and third homes, you know? And as I said earlier on, when I chose to do the tour, I really chose to go wherever I felt like going. And obviously Detroit was one of the places because I'd had a lot of good times there, and the audience had always been great. The opening act, going to your first question, we are the opening act and the closing act.
That's what I figured. My friend asked me about it, and I said, well, he probably won't have one.
Well, there's no point in getting people musically confused, you know? I mean, if it had been 2 or 3 years ago, I'd have had the Stray Cats doing it, but now I'd have to open the show for them.
Good point.
Laurie?
I really think that the whole, because the music is so diverse, it's nice to start and finish the show and like take everybody right down my current little journey.
Okay, Laurie, thank you for your questions. We're going to move on now. We have Dana calling from Washington and listening on DC 101. Dana?
Hello, Dana?
Yes, hello, Robert.
Hi, Dana, how are you?
Hi, fine, how are you?
Fine. Didn't I see you, No, I've said that before.
No, my question to you was, now that you've become a solo artist, what kind of recording freedoms have you noticed that you've gotten more along the lines artistically? What kind of control do you have over an album more than you did, say, with a group, Led Zeppelin?
It's an interesting question. I mean, I have ultimate freedom because I make the record myself. I don't get the record company involved at all. No parent record companies or anything like that. So I can make the record, scrap it, make it, put it away in a basement, make another one without anybody having any demands on me. I mean, there would be nothing worse than having a record contract where you have to fulfill some kind of weird artistic obligation, like turn out 2 records a year and stuff like that, which it used to be years ago. So it's completely down to my judgment as to what I do and how often I do it and when I do it for the best. And I have ultimate freedom in the actual making of the record. I do about perhaps an 18-hour day behind doors, closed doors in the studio, and then crawl out of there about 4 o'clock in the morning, bump into a few cows and horses and sheep because it's in the country where we work, and then get up and start again. But it's really down. The only problem that I might have is that some of the musicians do tend to go to sleep occasionally.
All right.
Well, we can move late hours. Well, you enjoy it more since you've got total control of everything. It's more your own work, and it's what you want to be put out, right?
I think you're right, yeah. I'm not that there was ever any constriction in what was done before. It's just that this time, if I make any mistakes, or if the if the record is not up to a certain standard, then it's up to me to decide whether it is or whether it's not. I don't really have to take everybody into consideration quite as much, although it would be unfair to say that I was a dictator. I just know what I like, you know?
Dana, thank you for your calls. We have one next from Mark, calling from right here in Chicago and listening on the loop. Mark, what's your question for Robert Plant?
Yes, I'd like to know whatever came of that reunion with Yes and a couple of the other band members from Zeppelin, former group.
Well, Mark, it's very nice to talk to you, and it's very interesting to know that things like that actually... people actually believe things like that when there is absolutely no foundation. You see, unfortunately, Mark, you and I, depending on what we're listening to and who's telling us, are susceptible to believing anything that's about. And Chris Squires and Alan White were in the middle of a new project, which is now virtually complete and is very, very, very good. And you'll be hearing about it very shortly. But in the meantime, when they were just fooling around, and musicians do tend to do that together, or even with members of the public occasionally, they did some sort of fooling around with Jimmy for a while and asked me if I wanted to sing for a little bit, but I mean, it wasn't serious. And I couldn't do it anyway because I was in the Honey Drippers and we were busy playing the bars in North England. Yeah. So there's no importance to it at all. It's just that lots of musicians do happen to play together. I mean, Jimmy Page, Jeff Beck, and Eric Clapton are playing in the next 3 weeks together.
Yeah.
You know, but I mean, that doesn't mean to say that they're going to be together for the rest of their lives.
Yeah.
Because somebody's got to make it.
Do you also have Peter Grant working with you? No. Peter Grant.
Not anymore, no.
It is.
Peter Grant, is he working with you anymore?
No, he's not with me anymore. I mean, we're still very good friends, but we, right now I'm working on my own.
Alrighty. Mark, thank you for calling. You mentioned the Honey Drippers, Robert. That's sort of a little pickup band that you had, and you played some gigs unannounced. Do I have that right?
Mm-hmm.
Doing old rock and roll tunes and R&B tunes?
Yep.
Okay. Let's throw the whole ball over to Lee right now. And Lee, you have a question for Robert here?
Yeah, Robert, in Milwaukee, when you just played there, not only was the show magnificent and the band amazingly tight and the lights and the perfect show, but you were very loose. Do you feel less pressured on the road now than you did in the past? Is it?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I'm. It would be a bit sort of wrong of me to say that I feel better now, but I do. As with the recording, if I'm going to be a fool, then I can be a fool in my own time now. I mean, it's not that that I miss or need or rely particularly on anybody or anything. I mean, the first night I walked out on stage in Peoria, Illinois, was probably the most amazing. And I mean, we're all sitting here. This is kind of part of a job in a way. It's an interesting night, and you're all nodding your heads and going, yeah, 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 what time's the Jive 5 on the TV, you know? But I mean, for me, it was like walking to the front of the stage and picking up the microphone was... After 6 years of not being in America, or 6 years of not even contemplating the reaction of an audience, it was kind of remarkable to do that. And so right now, I mean, I've got the bit in my teeth and I'm enjoying it and dancing around like mad. And there is a different atmosphere as well, both on stage and in the crowd. And the crowd atmosphere is remarkable. I mean, it no longer possesses that kind of hard rock element. It's kind of real... good feeling, good vibe, if I can use the word vibe in the 80s, yeah, and it's great, it's really, really nice, the smiles everywhere, and the auditoriums, from what I've heard further down the road, are virtually full or are full, and it's like me coming back again, welcome home type thing.
Welcome home.
That's right. What do you say we hear some Robert Plant music? Get into the album, The Principle of Moments. Do I have this correctly? Big Log has been released as a single also?
Big Log has not only been released as a single, in fact, I think this week is 33 in the Billboard chart.
Hmm.
Is that correct?
31.
31 in the Billboard chart, in the singles chart. So.
And there is a video?
There is a video indeed, yeah.
Well, let's hear the record right now. This is Big Log on the Loop. That's the tune Big Log from The Principle of Moments, Robert Plant's latest and second solo LP. You're listening to the Robert Plant Radio Conference. It's broadcast nationwide, live from the studios of WLUP Chicago.
And, of course, you're listening to that, the home of rock and roll in Philadelphia, 93.3 WMMR. Hopefully, when Robert Plant comes by here and plays a Spectrum, hopefully we'll be able to get Robert into the studio. And we'll be back with more of the press conference in just a moment. WMMR in Philadelphia. Robert's now talking with Stephanie in Philadelphia about Phil Collins joining them on the tour.
And after that, I mean, we do get on very well, and we should all be in well. Work together in the future. I'm hoping to join Genesis next week as well.
Oh, remember where you heard it.
Now, No.
Before we ask, thank you, by the way, Stephanie. Before we ask Lee Arnold from 93 QFM in Milwaukee to ask a question, I think the time is right for you to introduce all of us nationwide to your new band.
Yeah, okay. How's it going stage? On bass guitar from Leicester, England, Paul Martinez. Yeah. And then there's a sort of somebody blows a trumpet from behind me. And then from New York, a multi-talented and a very kind of hard-working guy who I'm getting to know more and more by the day is Bob Mayo. He works with Foreigner currently, and he's worked with Aerosmith, Peter Frampton, all sorts of folk. He's a great guy. He's potential. I mean, I don't know half of his potential right now. We usually pass in the corridor in the hotel. Phil Collins on drums needs no introduction, really. Jez Woodruff, sort of the unknown man from Wales, the wild man of Wales. He's a nice, quiet guy, never buys a drink.
Oh, one of those.
Yeah, well, if he does, he buys everybody in the bar a drink but us. And on guitar, the man who's never bought anything, Robbie Blunt.
Who you compose with these days?
Well, if you look, I think the principle of moments is like Paul, myself, and Jez, and Robbie. A lot of the time, but in the beginning it was Robbie that drew me
out. The first LP.
Mm. Robbie and I, living very close to one another, we were far more accessible one to the other, and we used to work in the afternoons, work at night, go to the pub, come back, work again. I mean, but now the thing's has kind of taken off, it's got a different work direction, and we've all been living in each other's pockets. Well, not in their pockets, because nobody gets in there, but living
the money thing is coming up.
Oh, no, it's strange, isn't it?
Yes.
But we're living together a lot more closely now, so everybody's more involved, and I hope that Bob also would get involved a little bit, perhaps bring out one or two of his sort of post-60s classics. So it's good. Yeah, Robbie was there at the beginning, and Robbie still is there now.
Now Phil Collins is on drums for this tour.
And trumpet, yeah.
And trumpet, okay. Also on the LP, you use Barrymore Barlow, who from Jethro Tull. Cozy Powell has been used on drums for some tracks. And I understand for the European tour, to follow the U.S. tour, you're going to have Richie Hayward of Little Feet on drums.
Mm-hmm.
That suggests that you like to build a band around a drummer. Drummers are very important to you. Do we have this right?
Yeah, well, in the rehearsal situation, we worked Pick Withers. Late of Dire Straits worked with us. Jason Bonham played with us for a while. And Roger Taylor from Queen wasn't doing anything for the time being, and he played with us for a while. I mean, the thing is, the way I see it is, you get a musical structure and then you just stick a different drummer in and he kicks Paul one way or the other. The rhythm section is very important. Consequently, I like to try the framework of the songs with different guys, see which way it'll go, whether it'll go this way, that way, or the other way. And it makes the music far more elastic. The possibilities are a lot greater. Richie Hayward is excellent, and since Little Feet, he's not been doing a great deal. And his potential from Little Feet was one thing, but what he does with us is something, again, very different. It makes some of the songs a lot different. It's just a good foundation to keep changing drummers and perhaps...
You approached him with this idea, Richie Hayward?
Mm. Yeah. Said, come and spend a couple of days with us, and he was great.
Fascinating. Okay, we have Lee Arnold, 93 QFM in Milwaukee. Lee?
Yeah, Robert, the musicians that you picked to be with you on the album and on the tour, was there any kind of an auditioning process, or were they just, these were close friends? And then I also have a question about the only song that you did that wasn't yours, other than Little Sister, which makes sense, when you played Milwaukee, was a Whaler song, Lively Up Yourself.
Bob Marley.
Right.
Mm. Well, yes, they are close friends, the musicians. They didn't start off. Robbie was a close friend, obviously. But the other guys were, Paul was a friend of Robbie's, and Jez, we just happened to stumble on when we went into a music shop trying to get something for nothing, and he was working in there. So it isn't a case of, there was an audition process. Obviously it was important to see whether or not it would fit, work together, and it did work together first time, that's great. But with the addition of Bob Mayo, it makes the whole thing fill out a lot more. So it isn't a three-man group or anything like that.
Yeah.
Or a four-piece band or that sort of thing, because I think I've perhaps been a part of that for a while, and I think that might have been what people expected, you know?
All right, we have more people on the phone line ready to pose their questions to Robert Plant. Michelle, calling from Worcester, Massachusetts, listening on WAAF. Michelle.
Hi.
Hello, Michelle.
I'd like to know what the titles to your songs mean. Like, Big Log's my favorite song, but I can't figure out what that has to do with the song. The title?
Well, it's a good question, actually, and I can't really give you the answer to Big Log. There's nothing mysterious about it, but what happened was I I went away somewhere. I think I came to New York to do some... it was some illicit love meeting of mine, I think, or something like that, where I told the band I was going off to do some work and didn't. And when I came back, they got this... The whole rhythm track, the backing track for Big Log was down, and there was no room for any vocals or anything. It was like an instrumental. And I said to Paul, what's it called? He said, here, man, it's called the Big Log, you know? It was like, I suppose it must mean some kind of smoking thing, I don't know.
Spliff.
Spliff.
Oh, what? No, that was the 60s. But normally, I just... Titles kind of crop up out of nowhere, and they're usually very comical ones. And it seems a shame to suddenly get very kind of pompous.
Yeah.
And put a really serious title on the end of something like... I mean, Mystery Title from the first album didn't read... There was nothing you could put on it about there's a man in a suitcase standing in a darkened room, message light is burning and the blinds are always drawn. It's every hotel in the world, but you couldn't call it Hotel Blues, you know?
Yeah.
Or the fact that all I ever do is keep moving. And things like Messing with the Mekon. You're best to ask Robbie Blunt that if he ever gets on here, because I can't tell you that one. But they're usually very... In fact, most of them are kind of humorous. Horizontal Departure is another very silly title. Relating to Paul doing some involuntary levitation through the air. sort of as if he was lying on a bed, but he was 4 feet up in the air. It was somebody biffed him on the end of his jaw and he sails through the air. Straight out the door. It was kind of funny, you know?
Michelle, thank you for your call. We're going to move on here. We're going to take a call from San Francisco. Kathy from San Francisco listening on KFOG. Kathy.
Hello, Kathy. Kathy.
Hello, Robert.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, I'm sorry, but there seems to be there's like an echo from the telephone to the radio.
It must be the sound engineer. It's probably Benji. He probably still thinks we're doing a gig.
And you might want to turn your radio down, Kathy. That would help as well.
I just did.
Atta girl.
Is that any better?
Yes, it does.
Okay, take one of these 3 times a day.
Call me in the morning.
Welcome, Robert. I would first like to say that I've always enjoyed your music from day one.
Thank you.
And, you know, a few years ago when Led Zeppelin broke up, I was very heartbroken. Because I enjoyed the music so much. But to see you come back with your own solo work has really brightened my life.
Well, thank you very much. It's really brightened mine, too.
Well, I'm glad to hear that.
Well, I was a bit too old to try and play soccer seriously. I don't know. I mean, Playgirl had turned me down 3 times, so there was not much left for me.
I doubt that.
Playgirl has nothing good in it anyway.
No, I know. I'm only pulling your leg.
You can come and pose for me anytime, though.
Okay, well, I said, okay. Where am I staying in San Francisco? Oh, I'll be in the usual place, Fisherman's Wharf.
Oh, well, listen, if you ever come to San Jose, you're welcome to come and stay with me.
Okay, you got 2 beds?
2?
Yeah.
What do you need 2 for?
I'm on a vow of celibacy. I'll see you there.
Now, wait a minute, I have a question.
Oh, sorry.
We thought that was the question.
Stay with me.
This is more like it, isn't it? And they're trying to wrap the show up and saying, get a move on. I like these kind of conversations.
Well, let's see. How long do you plan on or hope to continue your music?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I've seen what Jagger said about you can go on forever. And I guess that the predominance in popular music right now is either a load of boring old farts who keep churning out the same old stuff on a kind of, what they call in America, that kind of...
Corporate formula?
Yeah, formula rock, there we are. or there are lots of new bands coming around the corner. Now, if I can keep on being stimulated in the best possible way, with you or without you, you know, by what's coming around the corner, then I reckon I can continue indefinitely. I mean, I think the music on the new album is pretty competitively current, and I would defy that if you were to play some of the cuts like In the Mood or Messing with a Mekon and people didn't know who it was, it's as kind of new in its approach as a lot of the stuff that's around that's considered to be not avant-garde, that's not fair. But I mean, it's happening, and as long as it happens and I don't have to go backwards, then I should keep doing it.
Well, I sure hope so, because your music is great.
Well, thank you. I try.
Kathy, thank you for your call.
You're listening to the Robert Plant press conference. Robert, of course, formerly of Led Zeppelin, on 93.3 WMMR.
You toured until now, and that is the advent and the development of music videos. Can you sort of, my question would be a two-headed question here, talk about the role of a video as it relates to touring, and in other words, I think there's a tendency for some people to think that a video can sort of replace touring, and I would think that's not your philosophy.
No, I don't think that's the case. I think I haven't quite worked it out yet, because if you're in a hotel or something like that, you've always got the chance of seeing cable TV. That doesn't mean to say cable TV goes to everywhere in the world or everywhere in the United States. So it's a kind of the impression that you get of the power of video and its selling power and stuff like that, and it's making an artist more accessible, can be a bit you can kind of over anticipate what it actually does, you know. It doesn't sell, it doesn't alternate, it doesn't replace the tour, but I think what it does is probably gives you a fair representation of what the artist's all about. Because you see a hard rock song, generally there's a guy in a leather jacket and there's some chicks and stuff like that, and I made the mistake with Burning Down One Side of having the usual kind of syndrome, you know. And then videos can be kind of arty, and I think perhaps Duran Duran actually cover that kind of feel, and Bowie too, you know. And you get some of the more tasteful stuff is very interesting as a concept, but it's got nothing to do with going out on the road, and you can't put a good video to a bad record,
right?
Although there's a lot of it being done,
right? And I imagine the euphoria that you spoke of in Peoria, you took the stage, I imagine that's a rush unlike you could feel in any other circumstances.
You can't buy rushes like that.
I imagine not. Back to the phones here. How about it? We have Tim calling from Albuquerque, New Mexico. Wow. And listening on KWXL. Tim?
Hi, how you doing?
Hi, Tim. How are you?
All right.
Nice to have a man on the show.
Yeah.
It's been so many chicks. It's remarkable.
Yeah, they all like you, yes. I was wondering if we got a petition going around and got over 5,000 people to sign it, if you come here.
Well, here's my situation. I'd love to come, and I think I'm going to be, if this tour goes well, I'd like to come back in, say, February or March. Now, at the moment, Mr. Collins' work schedule is such that he's only got 3 hours off between finishing this tour and starting another one. So, unless we can squeeze it in the middle or somewhere like that, it's going to have to be February or March. But I did enjoy playing there last time. I don't suppose you were. It was a long time ago. I remember coming over the mountains and landing there, and it was really neat. And the town was neat. Met a few friends there. But I don't think this time, I don't think there's any room, you know. I'm working harder now than I ever have done before. But I should bear it in mind and promise. Well, get it together anyway.
Okay.
Okay, bye.
Alrighty, we have Annette calling from Carbondale, Illinois, resort town, and listening on WTAQ. Annette.
Hello, Robert.
Hello, Annette. How are you?
Pretty good. First of all, I want to say that I enjoy you as a solo artist, and keep up the good work. You're my favorite.
Thank you.
And my question is, Pledge Pin is my favorite song on the first album. Could you tell me what the song's about?
Yeah, it's about a woman, or even a man, but it's written as in a woman's part. Who is the most beautiful and the most attractive and the most potentially powerful person in the situation. And all the guys are wandering around her, and she's all the time she's playing them down the line, and she's teasing them and goodness knows what. And at the end of the day, as the cavalcade begins to thin and she starts to look around it, it's too late, because she's been so selective and so choosy about the guy who's going to walk her to her front door that there's nobody left.
Interesting song.
Well, it's not an interesting song. It's terrible if you've ever been in that predicament.
It's different from anything I've heard.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, I've seen it a lot in clubs and stuff like that. You get somebody so foxy when she walks in and she's like, nobody can get near her, and she's really in a world of her own. And then suddenly she's real lonesome as the house lights come up, and she's sitting there and she was so choosy that all she's got is an empty glass and a broken date.
Mm. I'll take her.
Well, I would too.
Yes.
I was her once. I remember it a million nights.
Annette, good question. Thank you very much. All right, let's throw it on over to Lee from 93 QFM in Milwaukee.
Robert, have you been approached to get into the cinema or movies in your future? You're a great-looking guy. And,
it's very sweet of you.
It's my pleasure.
Break it up.
But I would think that would be something that you might consider.
I was talking to David Bowie the other night about it because we were chewing the cud one night. We both got a night off. You either have to be a master of it or you shouldn't even try. And I think my forte is really just going on stage as the house lights go down and singing. I mean, I can do that reasonably well, but I wouldn't like to go through all the rigmarole of doing things wrong time and time again. On the other hand, I enjoyed making Big Log. What all I had to do was walk to a freezer and get a can of Coke out and look at a windmill going around and drive a car, you know? But I don't think I've got the right accent, and I don't think I've got the patience to do that. And I don't think I'm a bit old now for all that. Although Fabian did it and James Darren.
Hey, Elvis?
Yeah. Oh, well, he was
some great movies, huh? Mm.
Now a question from Lee Arnold of Casey.
I'll do Jack Silver.
Excuse me.
I'll do my Jack Silver imitation.
Please do.
Your mom's listening to this as well.
Yes. Hello, Mom. And Robert, continuing on with Lee's concept of your future, you have a new record label, and maybe you can touch on Robert Plant, the businessman, as it relates to your future.
Well, it ain't really business. I just wanted my own identity. Basically, that's what I wanted. I mean, the project is so new, it's so invigorating, it's exciting, it's everything that you can imagine, and I wanted it to have its own kind of cradle, if you like. And so if it gets any more ambitious, I think it might overtake what I'm trying to do myself, and I don't want that to happen. But at the same time, if there was a new Stray Cats around the corner, or if the Fabulous Thunderbirds decided they were fed up with it.
We are rapidly drawing to a conclusion here. Let's dip right back into the album. I think this is my favorite. Everyone should pick their own. From the album, The Principle of Moments by Robert Plant. You're hearing it here on The Loop, and you're hearing it nationwide. Let's get in the mood.
That's better. if you want me to. I think really perhaps that song epitomizes and typifies where I'm coming from, and if Lawrence Welk can have a signature tune, then I'm sure that I should have that one for me. It's a great song, it's so simple, its intentions are really good, and as the song says, although I hate quoting my own lyrics, I'm not very good at talking in between numbers either on stage, I can do it right, I can do it wrong, but it'll turn out strong, you know, and I am really in the mood. It's been great being here. It's kind of a little contrived situation for a sort of medium heavyweight rock and roller to be stuck in this environment, waffling to you guys and talking to people all over the country, but I really enjoy it, and I think it's all part and parcel of what I'm doing. These are new days, and I am in the mood. Thanks, guys, and thank you, America.
Thank you, Robert. I also like to thank our guests, Lee Arnold, 93QFM, Jack Silver, Keishi. This has been the Robert Plant Radio Conference, a DIR production. Executive producers Bob Myrowitz and Peter Koff. Producer Paul Zullo. Station coordinator Roxy Mizell. From the Robert Plant Organization, special thanks to Tony Smith and Perry Cooper and Phil Carlson from Atlantic Records. Certainly deserve a mention. Our friends at Ms. Lou. Our radio panel, as we just mentioned. Also from WLUP, Tom Knauss, Dan Michaels, Greg Salk, Jim DeCastro, and the entire WLUP staff. Speaking for myself, Bobby Scafish, it's been a gas. It's been a riot, a real thrill. And bidding you...
Things. Sorry, all those things in one.
and more. From WLUP Chicago, I bid you good night.
And Phil... If you're
Labor Day Block Party Weekend with 10 in a row every hour... WYSP.